alluded to this last week as he was talking about God's infinity. And it's true again tonight. You can look at any historic confession, any Reformed doctrinal statement, anything you can read, and no one ultimately can come close to describing God accurately. Yes, to repeat something else Josh said, he said we cannot know God fully, but we can know Him truly, right? And so it is good for us to study deep things like this that cause us to really think carefully and deeply to know what we believe. And I often hear people just in conversation at work, especially where when you get to anything of religious or spiritual, people will often try to avoid anything deep and say, I heard phrases like, I just don't think we're supposed to know anything. Now, that's true in the sense that we can't know everything, right? But that's not an excuse to say we shouldn't study and try to know. And so obviously we can agree that there are difficult concepts for us, like infinity, I speak. But let it not be said of us that we've not attempted to know God truly. For example, when we think about the first two attributes, something that demonstrates how difficult they are for us to understand is just the way we name them, infinity and immutability. And they are so difficult for us to understand that we can't even give them a positive description name. We describe them in what they are. So God is not finite. So that's all best we can say, and that's infinity, right? And so tonight we're looking at God is unchanging, or He's not mutable, immutability, and that's where the name of that comes from. We struggle to wrap our minds so much about that that we have to say in the name. So we'll start with. I've been studying church history for a while, so I'm really looking at all these documents. This is called the Belgic Confession. This is from the 15th century, actually, it says 16th century. Or excuse me, 16th century, it says 1618 on there, but that's just when it was last revised. Another fun fact, and this will be my last fun fact tonight. The Synod of Dort in the Netherlands, and I don't know if you paid attention to news recently theologically, but in that same place where this profound confession was made long before the Westminster, now they want to persecute people who hold to a consistent view of Scripture. Interesting, but I will read that. This is Article 1 of the Belgian Confession. It says, we all believe in the heart and confess with the mouth that there is only one simple and spiritual being, which we call God, that He is eternal, incomprehensible, invisible, immutable, infinite, almighty, perfectly wise, just, good, and the overflowing source of all good. So even for centuries, we've held this idea that God is immutable. We do that history. And so tonight, we're going to start by defining immutability biblically and theologically. And so a simple definition of immutability is that God does not change. And so when you think about this attribute by itself, apart from being divine, it's not necessarily a good thing. If you are incredibly wicked and immutable, that would be bad. Or if you are in line at the doctor's office or the ER and you are immutable, that would be bad. No one wants to sit in the doctor's office forever without changing. But as a divine attribute, it is a perfection. And so it's not just a perfection about that. It belongs to every attribute. You'll see that as we go through the study that in describing one attribute of God, you inevitably describe others because they're all intertwined. One theologian said this, that God is whatever He has, and all that He is, and all that He has, can never change. Immutability is what it means for God to be God. Herman Bogdan said this, if God were not immutable, He would not be God. And so when you think about this, if God were mutable, that would mean that He undergoes change. And so for if God experienced any kind of change, then logically that would imply that at some point God was either less than He now is or more than He now is. Right? God cannot increase or decrease, but He cannot grow or increase, because that would mean if He is, then He's either changing for the better or for the worse. And if He is changing in some way for that, then He cannot be God. Francis Turner said it this way. He can either be changed for the better because he is the best, nor the worst because he would cease to be the most perfect. Furthermore than that, you know, God is not just a being. We have being as humans. We are human beings. The theologians have often called God being, meaning that God is being himself. Everything that has its being has it in him. That's what God in the beginning said. He is an immeasurable, boundless ocean of being, so intertwining with God's infinity. Another statement from theologians is this, that God is of himself, and there is no becoming in God. Through this quote, I've heard from Bobby again. That the difference between the creator and the creature hinges on the contrast between being and becoming. All that is creaturely is in the process of becoming. It is changeable, constantly striving, in search of rest and satisfaction. And so when we talk about immutability, this is an attribute like infinity was. It's incommunicable. God does not share this with anybody else. And this is something that makes him totally distinct from everything in creation. He's unchanging. So, more than that, is this teaching in the scriptures? Because ultimately that's all that matters. So let's look at some verses that teach this. First, we'll look at Exodus 3:14. It says, God said to Moses, and he said, say this to the people of Israel, I am has sent me to you. And so earlier, I mentioned that many theologians just call God, or describe God as being all of being, or pure being. The passages like this are talking about. So when you look at Exodus 3, God is not a kind of being one day, right? In a different kind of being in the future. We can call God the one who was and is and is to come, but thinking of his essence and knowledge, he is the I am. So he's the I am God, outside of time, outside of all of our measurements. The very name of God, Yahweh or Lord, speaks to this. In other words, there's no possibility of the I am ever being anything other than what he now is. So he's unchanging. He is. Second case, number 23:19, says this. God is not man that he should lie, or a son of man that he should change his mind. Has he said, and will he not do it? Or has he spoken, and will he not fulfill it? And so, notice the differentiation in the text between God and man. So, first of all, God doesn't lie. Men lie all the time. He always does what is true. So, second, he is not a son of man, because he does not change his mind. And so, God is not the kind of being that would ever do or say anything untrue, according to this text. He's not the kind of being that can ever be anything other than what he is. So he's totally unchanging. He is what he is. And he does what he says. So there's no mutability in him. No change. No mutation. Look at this text, Psalm 102. 25-27 says, of old you laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the work of your hands. They will perish, but you will remain. They will all wear out like a garment. You will change them like a robe, and they will pass away. But you are the same, and your years have no end. So, the passage we just looked at in Numbers 23, this compares God to his creatures. Now, he's not a man that he should lie. So now we see God in comparison to his creatures. So, you can think about this way, regarding God's immutability. Now, every one of us woke up this morning, and if there's one thing that we counted on, without even thinking about it, it was this. Nobody in here thought, when they stepped out of bed, is the earth going to be there? Or is the sky going to be above my head? We don't think about those things. Whatever stresses we have, anxieties, whatever things we think about, work, family, kids, struggles, health struggles, financial struggles, I guarantee none of you, anybody think about a given, right? It's a given that the earth's going to be there when I get up. But even that, when you look at Psalm 102, as given as those things are, they're not as given as God. God is more firm, more secure, more sturdy than the earth and the sky and the facts that they'll be there. Psalm 102, he also says, the heavens and the earth will wear out. And God can change them like a robe. And so again, just thinking about God's bigness and his unchanging, we think of a small child, Bennett, our 18-month-old. She can put a hat on. She can put on some of the different clothes. That's easy. You can do anything with yourself to do it. God does that. What's the problem? He goes up in the sky, the earth, everything. He never changes. So you see, the song of praises God for his eternity. They will perish, but you will remain. Then he praises God for his eternity. You will change them like a robe, but you are the same. Isaiah 46, you're going to turn it around. This second part of this. Isaiah 46, 8 through 10. James is connecting that to his immutability. And so So we know that God is only good and he's always good because it's impossible for him to ever be something more or something less than God. You think of it this way, there is no potential in God. Our whole life, we are striving to reach something else. We're trying to do something better. There is no potential in God. God is utterly always perfect in every attribute of his character. So there is no potential. There is no possibility of God ever being better. He's infinite outside of that. And James says that even further, so there's not even a shadow of change. There's not even any evidence of change. It doesn't even look like he changes. And we see it truly. And so in summary of these passages, we can say that God is immutable in his essence, his knowledge, his will, and purpose. His nature cannot be altered for better or worse. His knowledge can never increase or decrease. Anything he purposes comes to pass. He is all being, no becoming. There are no latent possibilities in God. There is no thing that he could do later to change him or make him better. Nothing can be added to him or subtracted to him. He needs nothing. He learns nothing. He does not grow. He does not improve. He does not change. And so we see that all throughout the scriptures. So there you go. There's a short definition and some biblical evidence. First, I kind of want to move to this next section here, where we're going to look at some challenges and objections that we often hear to God's immutability. And so, obviously, there are people who hate the gospel and would love to poke holes in immutability. That's not really what I'm looking at. I kind of want us to think about the hard text, harder ideas, and challenges that are often brought forth by honest believers who are simply trying to reconcile this with their understanding of scriptures. Now, you guys are in an awesome position because you're members of a church that strives to be biblically consistent. But a lot of people don't think about any of these things. So I got these from a list when I was studying, but some of them are thinking, I thought that was really a challenge to this. But I hope this is helpful. But first, challenge is creation. So, how do you square God's immutability with creation? So you can think of the question this way. How could God be immutable if he created the world out of nothing? You can say more. So think of it in these terms. Would God have had to take on a new characteristic and become a new person? So let's get rid of a frame of question this way. Before the question is with you. was getting real close last week, and if God was alive, you know, I think that's what I'm saying. Trying to think of God being eternal. We try to picture that we can't. That actually was new, and that God performed creation, right? But there was no new will. Think of it this way. God executes what he does in time. God executes in time what he decreed in time. And so, when you think of creation, when you look at the cosmos, you look at what God made and that manifests in his creation. You look at the Christians, believers, and we manifest God as Savior. But God is not dependent on anything he made or us to be those things. He's outside of us. He's fully dependent in himself. So God does not take on a characteristic of Creator just because he created, but because he intended for all eternity of God to create. He could always create. He didn't acquire a new power to create. He gained no new perfection to create. And so the glory was manifest in a new way, but if any change or newness that we see is just on our side, right? We see it as change, but there's no change in God. Hopefully that's helpful. Think of it this way. I can say that the Son of God took a nap or got hungry or died. All those things are true. But you cannot say the divine nature. You can't say the divine nature got hungry. You can't say the divine nature died. Right? If the divine nature died, all the universe would have collapsed on itself, right? At the moment. And so the point is, what can be predicated about the human nature can be said about the person, but not automatically about the other nature. The point being, there was no change in the divine nature, right? There was no change in God in the incarnation. So we see this in Scripture. Acts 20 talks about God's blood. Of course, God is a spirit, right? God doesn't have blood. But the human nature, the Lord, blood. He still did. He died. And what about the hymn? I'm not going to sing it. And can it be that my God should die for me? Now, if the divine nature died, we had a big problem. Actually, in studying for this, I listened to the R.C. Sproul sermon where he went on a 5-minute rant mad that John Wesley didn't change the words. Said that it should have been my Christ to die for me. Obviously, we understand that John Wesley didn't mean that, but it makes sense when we think about what he's saying. So the divine nature is now, that's the heresy. If you can consumption. So that is the divine nature assumed of human nature. Jesus Christ is truly God and truly man. Okay, so it's the union of two natures. He didn't lose anything from the divine nature by taking on human nature. He doesn't have to play by the rules that we would think he does. Or have to be 50%, 50%. He doesn't have to do that. He's got to do anything he wants to. So he assumes the human nature. And in what will have to blow my mind most probably of all the miraculous things to think of, just the incarnation. That's crazy to think about it. And so we serve an awesome God, but it's the union of two natures. So God did have to subtract some of himself. And taking on human nature. He's not a humanized deity. He's not a deified human. He's the God-man. And so, think of it this way. I mean, the Son of God assumed the human nature. Both natures preserved their specific qualities. So he took on extra. But he didn't lose any of himself. Herman Bobbitt said this: neither creation nor revelation nor incarnation are about any change of God. About this challenge. I'll say this ahead of time. This is by far one of the more hard ones to even think about. So this is something to think about. What about God repenting? Or God changing his mind? Now, first, what are you talking about? There are passages to say this. It's old scripture, right? So we have to be ready for difficult texts like this. Look at the times in Scripture where the Bible says God repents or God changes his mind. Well, for that matter, what about all the affectionate language of God? Actually, years ago, I interviewed for this pastor job at a church in Lebanon. God saved me from that. But they wouldn't give it to me anyway, kind of scouting. But before that, when he found out I was Calvinist, chairman of the deacon, this was something he said to me. He was really nice, by the way. They were great. They weren't mad about it. But he called me on the phone and said, "What do you think about predestination?" So, I know he should just ask me. But I said, "Well, you know, it's a good one. It's true things in Scripture. We have to do it." And I said, "I mean, I know there might be some hard passages that make you question that." He said, "But I think you can avoid it." And he said, "No, I believe we can change God's mind." You know, from there, I went on and I quoted him like 100 times in my life. But there's texts that are hard, right? That may make you think that. Now, I don't know, but I thought about it later, but there's a text in the Old Testament where God basically, or excuse me, Moses, which is like a fairly good one, right? And text, some translations say God changed his mind. Some say he relented. But how does that square with the evangelical? I mentioned there, what about the affectionate language about God loving or sadness or God feeling his wrongs and griefs? I didn't change. So, this is some fun vocabulary. Second word you've probably heard before, anthropomorphism. I've heard that school of that. First one, anthropopathism. I've practiced that a lot. Two words you may have never heard before, but here's the first response to that question about God repenting. Is the idea of this: there are anthropopathisms and anthropomorphisms in the Bible. So, morphism. And that's when you ascribe to God a human body part. So God sees with his eyes. It's God's arm too short to reach us or whatever. Now, second, anthropopathism is when you ascribe to God a human emotion. Right? So remember, when we're thinking about God and his nature, he's not an animal. Not a man, so we have to be careful not to think of him in those terms. So when the Bible says God had an arm for a nose or an eye or a hand or a foot, we automatically this has been the answer for centuries. And so perhaps it might say more about us today that we don't accept that than it does about them. Because theologians in history have stumbled this way. Read this from Charles Hodge. He said, those passages in Scripture in which God is said to repent are to be interpreted on the same principles as those in which he is said to, quote, ride upon the wings of the wind, or walk through the earth. These create no difficulty. He can say that, the guy with five volumes. He can say no difficulty in these texts. But there is biblical support. And really what he's saying, just to confirm that, I mean, there are interpretive principles of Scripture. No, God is not man, God is not human. And our characteristics are not found out, right? So regardless of the dangers that we do, we have to know that first of all, God is far outside of our emotion. God is not captured, he's not led by any passions like us. So we have to remember that. So is there biblical support for this? Let's look at a couple of texts. We're going to look at 1 Samuel 15. This is the only one we're going to go through about God returning and their love. Just your version when they say it's part of it, it's a different verb. This is 1 Samuel 15:11. It says, I regret that I have so okay, 40 years. So Saul, the king of Israel, he sinned, he disobeyed. Here we are. This is God speaking. I regret that I have made Saul king, for he has turned back and followed me, and has not performed my commandments. See Saul in the day of death, but Samuel grieved over Saul, and the Lord regretted. So, we regret. Clearly, God regretted. But in what manner did he do it? How are we supposed to understand? People might argue how that plays out, or they might argue about God decreed it all. But even if he didn't, think about this for a second. Even if God didn't decree it, but his omniscient, and let it play out, how can he do it? Is there anything that omniscient God can be surprised at? No. Now we believe in truth. He's working it out of providence. But even if he didn't, and someone wants to argue from that side, if God's omniscient, he doesn't regret it the way he ended. Because there is no scenario that could have played out from Saul that ever would have took God by surprise. He knew it already, so there was no regret. At least in the way that we could. I said in the beginning, let it not be said of us that we need to try to understand things that we do. Right. Hopefully that's what we will always do. There you go. The immutability of God. Let's move towards some application in the last few minutes. So what does the immutability have to do with anything? Does it matter to us whatsoever? Kevin Young. This is terrible news for those who are unwavering in their wickedness and unbelief. Terrible news. God is not going to have a change of heart on the last day, right? He did not deny himself. He did not deny his word. He did not deny his nature. Yeah. And so, there are millions of people in the world in our churches hold on secretly to an unfounded hope. And when they meet God in their sin, that he will surprisingly and unexpectedly change. They think that on that day, God will be mutable. People everywhere hope in him. They think that he will not be the God that cast out Adam. Or destroy them outright, or destroy Uzzah when he touched the ark. They think that he won't be that. What about the God who caused the earth to open up and swallow the sons of Korah, those in the rebellion? Or the God who, through John the Baptist, warned the Israelites that the wrath could come. promises are sure and secure in Christ, and they cannot be ignored. When the Lord gave the word to Malachi, the Lord did not change. And then we mentioned the second part. Therefore, you all, the children of Jacob, are not consumed. God's immutability is great news to them, right? He's saying, you've broken my commandments. You've broken my covenants. You deserve my wrath, destruction, fully. You deserve to be consumed. That's how Malachi says it. But you're my people. I'm not changing God. I promise. I'm a deliverer. I'm full of compassion. And so, divine immutability is an attribute of perfection and a doctrine of comfort. Our eternal happiness is infallibly secure. You know the hymn. Great is thy faithfulness, O God my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever will be. The first number. It's unchanging. Third, last, for our worship. Our God is totally distinct from the world. He's not like us in creation. He's not like us. When you think of all the differences between God and us, we are inconstant in truth. Right? We lie, like the text says. We're inconstant in will, inconstant in practice. We don't always do what's consistent. We're inconstant in our affections. We're weak and undependable, but God is infinite, dependable, faithful, and constant. Hebrews 13:8. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And so, the God-man provides a way for immutable people to be in relationship with the immutable God. Amen? That's what we do a lot. We have a desire to be consistent. We have a desire to be constant. We have a desire to settle ourselves. But we don't. We stay in the way. Let it not be said of us. The only way to overcome the change and immutability in ourselves is to know the one with essence, knowledge, and feel and everything. That is the immutable God that we serve. Hopefully that's helpful. I pray for us. God, we're thankful for just the character that you show us in Scripture of yourself. We realize we cannot know you fully, but we are fully known in the gospel, Scripture says. We know you truly through the God of Jesus Christ. We ask that you would help us take these things to heart, that they would
Whoa!
Thank you.